Thank you for joining us this week on Crossfire Television. We're excited for what God is doing. Man, there is some great changes, great things ahead and in store for Crossfire Ministries. Today, we're going to talk about a name change for the church. This is a healing house. God is truly bringing healing to the house, and he's declaring it with a name change. Now, does that mean that we're going to be praying for the sick? Yes. Does that mean that we are going to be praying for those that are bound up with drugs and addiction like we always have? Yes. Does that mean that those that are sick and those that are lame, both physically, spiritually, emotionally, are we going to be praying and believing and seeing miracles like we are? Yes. So it's not that we're going to change the name to make it happen. We're going to change the name because it is happening. We're going to see God begin to take those that are hungry and bring forth provision. And I want to tell you today, this is a healing place. This is a healing house, the house of God. And so today we're going to talk to you about a change of direction, or at least a notification of a change of direction. And I believe you're a part of that. And so while Crossfire Ministries, Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, Crossfire Family of Ministries will still network and continue to reach out locally and internationally, this church, which is really the heartbeat of all that we do, will be having a name change. And today you're going to find out what it is, because it is truly speaking to who we are. And I want to encourage you to come and visit this church. If you do not have a church of your own, if you happen to be in the Eugene Springfield area, this church is a church that is welcoming. It is a church full of people who love God, who love his word, and who desire the move of the Holy Spirit every single time we meet. And so I want to encourage you to come. We are not going to allow COVID to stop us. We are going to push forward. We're going to see it eradicated in the name of Jesus. And we're going to see the power of God allow us to do his will, not only today, but moving forward into the very best that God has. Good things are ahead. Great days in store for Crossfire World Outreach Ministries and this amazing church, where truly this is a place, a house of healing. This morning we're going to talk about this house. This morning we're going to talk about this house, about Crossfire, what God is calling and asking for us to venture into. We're going to talk about a new journey for all of you that wish to come. Now, you can come to the church all you want, but today I'm going to ask you to go on a journey with me, to begin a journey today of a new adventure together. A journey into abundant living, a journey into the promise of God. But the question is, do you really want to go? Are you willing to lay some things down and walk into something new? Or do you just want to go to church? In one of the chapters in my book, if it makes it in past the final edits, which we're still waiting, they're saying March, they'll be ready to do the final. Then we still have cover art and stuff that we have to do, but one of the chapters is how to destroy a church. I have learned how to destroy a church. You know, years and years ago, I was asked to come and speak at an evangelism conference. And I went to this church and I spoke at this evangelism conference, and I had come from a different background, right? And so I just simply said, I'd like everyone to stand up and just greet the person next to you, tell them you love them, and tell them about Jesus. Right? It's an evangelism conference. They literally almost threw me out. They were so mad. I mean, I got through my set of messages I had to speak, but when it was all said and done, it was literally like, have you ever had a big conference, where you've talked a big conversation, and then when you get all done, somebody picks the very first thing you say and says, well, you know, and you're like, Did you miss everything I said past that point?
Yeah, pretty much.
I got caught up with when you asked us to do that. How dare you ask us? Folks, I want to tell you something. If that's your vision of church, to just come and leave, put a notch on your belt for the week that you did your thing, this ain't the church. One of the chapters is how to destroy a church. You want to know how you destroy a church? Expect people to love the unlovely. That'll tear it up. That'll cause people who say they're Christians to literally lose their minds when they've got to love somebody outside of their comfort zone. Well, we're going to take a step further now. Because if I haven't destroyed it enough, we're going to destroy it some more. We're going to ask that we actually do the Great Commission and we start walking in the supernatural. That we're going to start walking in the supernatural. This morning, a couple women got together to pray before service. The report was is that as God began to move, they began to laugh. Because the joy of the Lord filled this little prayer room with a couple people there. Folks, I want to tell you something. That sets an atmosphere for this place. But why does only a couple little women decide they're going to do that? Well, I want to tell you, thank God those little women have one really courageous spirit. And they can make a difference. But what would it be if everyone gathered together to seek God's face early? And some of you do, and I'm thankful for that. Today, we're going to change the name of the church. Some people say, well, why are we going to change the name? Why would we change the name of our church? Crossfire Family Worship Center. Well, we're a family. I think that's obvious. In fact, one of the emphasis we're going to do is the overall church name will be Crossfire, a family of ministries. So that will not be lost. But why would we change the name? Well, I want to tell you why. Because changing times cause us to walk into an increased calling and purpose. I want to say that again. I want you to catch it. Changing times, changing situations cause us to walk in an increased calling and purpose. There's an increasing of calling and purpose. And God values a name. It helps us keep focused. It causes the purpose to come out of us. Your title causes you to have access. Now, we're not big on religious titles around here. I rarely introduce myself by any kind of religious title. I'm Aaron. But God gives titles for a reason, because He wants there to be an access, a very renewed and distinct purpose. Well, I want to tell you that today, the name of the church will change simply because there is a focus that needs to be made and a distinct purpose that you begin to associate when you come to this church. Abram, his name in Genesis 17, 4 through 5, was changed to Abraham. Let me read it real quick. Genesis 17, he says, "As for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of many nations. No longer shall your name be Abram," which means exalted father. See, nothing really changed. He didn't have multiple sons. He had Ishmael and he had Isaac. What made him the father of many nations is what would come out of his seed. But also because God had promised that what He had given, He would pass down from generation to generation to generation, he would become the father of many nations. Now, what does that really mean? It means this: he would be a father multiplied. The Great Commission is called for us to take the works, the things that Jesus did, and multiply it to ever increasing our faith in Christ, ever increasing the Word of God, that it would not go from just greatness, it would go from greatness to greatness to greatness to greatness. Because, folks, every generation must choose. You cannot choose for your children. I cannot choose for my children, because I sure wish I could. But every generation must choose to serve the Lord. God changed Abraham's name, not because Abram was evil, not because it was bad, but because he was expanding. He was increasing the call and purpose on Abram's life to Abraham, an exalted father, to a multiplied father, a father of the multitude, a father of many nations. Then there's Jacob. And I'm not going to go through all of them. If I started to go through all of them, when God changed a place, when God changed a name, it would be ridiculous, to be honest with you. We'd be here all day. I want to just pick a couple, though. Jacob, heel grabber, supplanter, negative. And then he fought with God. He wrestled with God. And he said, I am not going to, this is Genesis chapter 32, I am not going to let go of you until you bless me. You remember the dislocation of the hip and all of that. And it says that the only thing that he did that really mattered was that when he became weak, he grabbed a hold of God's strength and he held on. Folks, I don't know about you, but when you become weak, you've got to learn, I've got to learn, that we grab a hold of God so that what is weak becomes strong. I wonder if 2 Corinthians 12:10, where Paul says, when I was weak, I am now strong. I wonder if that doesn't come from that very concept where the heel grabber's name is changed to Israel, one who strives with God, one who grabs a hold of God and lives. And then we see that Jacob turning to Israel, God's people learned that every generation had to choose for themselves to be blessed. It wasn't enough that Jacob was blessed and he brought a blessing on his family. And fathers and mothers, I want you to hear that. You need to be blessed so you can bring a blessing onto your family. But every generation will have to choose to walk in that blessing. We will not go until we're blessed. I want this church to be blessed so it can be a blessing. We're not going to be the tail. We're not going to be a heel grabber any longer, because our calling is great and sure because it's in God. What we're going to do as a church is we're going to contend with God, and we're going to hold on to Him so that His strength makes us strong. But that's a choice you'll have to make, folks. I had someone say once, he said, you know, Pastor, it seems like every service I have to choose, I have to change, something has to, can it just be easy? No, my calling is to push you a little. My calling is to herd a little. A little bit of, let's go this way, guys. You can't stand here and do nothing. You can't wander away from the flock. You can't get out where the devil will destroy you. And so together, what do? We begin to protect one another. And I see the small groups doing the same thing. And they're pulling in and they're herding. But if somebody wants to break and run from the sheep, the flock, you want to run from Jesus, that I can't stop that. If you want to live in your own devices and destroy your life and destroy the people around you and destroy your heritage, I can't stop that. Are you willing to hold on to God when it's unpopular? Because it's becoming very unpopular. Even in Christian church circles, it's becoming very unpopular. Are you willing to hold on to God? Are you willing to allow His word and His strength to strengthen you when it becomes unpopular? Number one, we cling. Are we clinging unto God? Number one, are we fully dependent on God, folks? Are we desperate for His blessing that we will not let go of Him? There's a little line there on your notes. It's either yes or no. There's really not an in-between. It's either yes I am or no I'm not. When we stop wrestling and start clinging, we will become strong and we will prevail over our enemy. But when we somehow ever think we can do it on our own, without His blessing, without His grace, without His strength, we will always fall short. And folks, as we go into various times of confusion, I want to say to you, for all of us, when you walk through times of confusion, and I believe they are more ahead than we could ever imagine, we still get to be victorious. We still get to be strong. If we are not dependent, or if we are dependent on God, if we're not dependent on God, we soon will be. I believe that. You will either have to reject God or choose Him. I believe the times are going to demand that. But we need His miraculous power, folks, to work within us. The house of God. The house of God. My Father's house. I'm going to run through some of these. I have to allude to some. I'd like to read them all. I just can't. But we're going to start in Luke chapter 14, verse 15. Luke chapter 14, verse 15. My Father's house. What does my Father's house look like, folks? There's a parable in Luke 14 about a great supper. It says this, "Now when one of those who sat at the table with him heard these things, he said to him, 'Blessed is he who shall eat or take dinner in the kingdom of God,'" or eat bread in the kingdom of God. My Father's house, folks, has provision. It's not in your notes there, but it has provision. It has what you need. My Father's house has everything you need. We do men's breakfast on Tuesdays. I love my men's breakfast on Tuesdays. Now we do it on Wednesdays also. At 6:30, it's a shameless commercial. So come hang out with us. We've never ran out of food. Because there's something about running out of food is a problem for me. I just don't want to run out of food. Can I tell you what's beautiful about our Father's house is you never run out of what you need. It is always enough to sustain you, and there's always a little left over. Folks, that's the truth about God. A, my Father's house should be full. That is the heart of God. And when I say the Father's house, I'm talking about this church. It is Jesus referred to it as a house of prayer. He referred to it as his Father's house. Folks, this house, this is a house of God. It is, yes, a place we meet. Yes, we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Yes, the church is not a place we meet. But I want to tell you, there is a house where we come together as people, and this is the house of God. Now, when one of those at the table came, they heard, they said, blessed are those who eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then he said, a certain man gave a great supper and invited many. Folks, they're invited. Why are you not inviting the people that God in your life into his house, into a place of worship, into a place of growing? Why are you not inviting those people that are in your life into the house of God? Because he said he invited many, and his desire is that it would be full. But at supper time, he said to his servants, go out and find those who are ready to come in, who are invited. For everything is ready, and it's time. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. First he said, I've bought a piece of ground, and I must go see to it. I've asked that you excuse me. Another, I bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to test them, and I ask you to excuse me. Still another, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that the servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house, being angry, said, go quickly out in the streets and the lanes and the cities, and bring here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. And the servant said, master, it is done as you've commanded, and there's still room. You know why? Because as this place fills up, God will expand this place. But are you okay? Have you already made excuse because you've lost interest in God? I mean, I'm talking to the choir. You're here. Maybe I'll talk to those that aren't. They're just peeking in. And some of you I know can't be. There's no criticism for that. But there's some who watch our messages online and they just kind of peek in. But they're not ready to make a commitment. I get a little comment here or there, or they'll say, man, I enjoyed that. But they're not really ready to come in. Folks, I want to ask you, are you ready to come into the family? Are you ready to come in all the way? He reaches out to the lame and he says, there's still room. So go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in that the house would be full. And I understand that what he's really talking about is the overall kingdom of God, not a specific place or church. For I say to you that none of those men who were invited shall even taste my supper. Why? Because they've rejected God. But folks, this represents the house of God, a place of meeting, a place of worship, a place of learning, a place of growing, so that we can go out and build the kingdom of God, so we can go out and build our homes and our lives, so we can go out and reach out with a great commission into the community, folks. We're asking, are you willing to be faithful to coming together, to growing, to learning? But it's not enough for you to become fat and lazy with the goodness of God's word. Are you willing to exercise your faith every day? Start walking in the supernatural. Allow the Holy Spirit to work through your life. Are you worried about being seen? Are you worried about being heard? Are you worried about, or are you wanting that God is seen and God is heard? As we lift him up, people will be drawn unto him. Because in my Father's house,
you have a place. John 14, he says, in my Father's house, meaning the kingdom, there's rooms, there's placements. Well, I want to tell you, in this church, we want to make sure in this house there is a place for everyone. Everyone that can feel welcomed, everyone that can be accepted, everyone who wants to walk into the things of God would find a place, and that they could truly see when Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth. No man comes to the Father unless they come through me. Narrow-minded, it's Jesus-minded. It all goes through him. To see, my Father's house is a place of prayer. Jesus said, it is written, my Father's house, or my house, is a house of prayer, and you've made it a den of thieves. Folks, this needs to be a place of prayer. This needs to be a place of supernatural enabling power. This needs to be a place where God moves. This needs to be a place like 2D where God resides. Genesis 28, 10. Jacob lays down. The place is called Luz. But the name is changed. And when it's changed with purpose. He says, now Jacob went from Beersheba down towards Haran, and he came to a certain place, and he stayed there all night because the sun had set, and he took a stone, and he placed it under his head, and he laid down in that place to sleep. Then he had a dream, and behold, a ladder was set up from earth, and its top reached the heaven, and angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Folks, if there is a picture of what I would want people to think of this church, wouldn't it be awesome if it was Jacob's ladder? A place, a Bethel, a place of spiritual access, a place where literally you have access to heaven, a place that is the house of God. That's what Bethel means. My Father's house, a house of God. He said, surely the Lord is in this place. I want people to come and recognize that the Lord is in this place. Not Aaron's in this place, not you're in this place, but God is here. Because where two or three are gathered in His name, in the Father's house, folks, He's going to be in the midst of them. And Jacob rose up early. Listen, he says, and he took the stone in which he had put his head, set up on it a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. Why? Well, because he anointed it. And he called the place of that house of God, or Bethel. But the name of the city had been previously Luz, and now Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and keep me in all my ways and in my going and causing bread and clothed. He's saying, if God takes care of me, I'm also going to be, and I didn't make this up. He says, I'm surely going to be faithful in tithing to him. That's what he said. You play with that one. Number three, we are anointed in this house. We are anointed in this house. Genesis 28:18, he says, he anointed that rock. Folks, this house needs to be a house of anointing. Do I get an amen out of that? What do you want your church to be? What do you want your church to be? If we have a great church with great music, but God's presence is in here, folks, absolutely there's no purpose. You can have a funny preacher. You can have a good preacher. You can have funny worship, good worship. You can have great worship. You can draw a big crowd. But if God isn't in the house, how many large crowds are in the building and God is weeping outside? Folks, are we even allowing or making place for the presence of God in our churches today? Well, I want to tell you something. I can't make a decision for every church, but I can make a decision for this church, and you can make a decision for this church. The third is, we've got to be anointed, because the yokes of bondage will take the power of God to be broken. Anointing means to set apart for a specific purpose. You know, it's not enough for me to be set apart. Every one of us have to be set apart for a specific purpose. We anoint something to set it apart for the purposes of God. They anointed the pieces of furniture in the house of God because they were set apart and they all had a certain specific meaning and a specific purpose. Folks, every one of us have to have a specific meaning and a specific purpose. What is your name? What is your gifting? What is your calling? And what is stopping you? You say, well, Pastor, I'm called to preach, and you seem to be up there all the time. You know what? Start where you're at then. Start where you're at then. Everybody's got an excuse. But start where you're at. And remember, you first, your gifts, we've said this so many times, your gifts are dependent on your fruit. What is the fruit of your life? Does it taste like Jesus when people eat of it? If it doesn't, your gifting becomes corrupt. Your gifting is without repentance. You're going to have it no matter what. But what ruins our gifting? Well, we do. Because of our lack of obedience to the call and to the work and to the Word of God. And when we don't walk in that, it literally sours the fruit of our life. Isaiah 61, we want to be anointed. He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach. Now what? This is what we want to see in our church. Good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open prison doors to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort those who mourn, to console with those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness. Folks, that's what the ultimate goal is. You begin to be a tree rooted in the house of God. The planting of the Lord, that what? That He may be glorified. That He is glorified. Your maturity, your anointing, your fruit causes God to be glorified. If you're trying to exalt yourself, you will be humbled. Why are we anointed? I believe we are anointed for a time such as this. Esther 4. I'm not going to turn there. I just want to. Esther 4 is definitely as a time. She had a purpose. Esther literally was called for a specific purpose, folks. John 16, 31, Jesus answered, "Do you believe? Indeed, the hour is coming. Yes, has come. You will be scattered, each to his own place, his own home, and will leave me alone. And yet, I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I've spoken to you, that you may have peace in this world. You will have tribulation." Folks, you've been called for a time of tribulation, but be of good cheer, Jesus said. Even though you've been called in a time of tribulation, even though you watch the news and it is depressing, even though it feels like all power has been taken from us, cling to your God. Cling to your God so that your weakness brings forth His strength. Cling to your God and let Him bless your life in the midst of turmoil. Cling to your God and let Him bring life in the midst of destruction. And even though there may be destruction all around, and even though the economy may be failing all around, the blessing of God can still be on your life. Is your faith in what you see, or is your faith in the God you serve? He says, be of good cheer. I overcame this world. I get to bless you no matter what. It doesn't matter about the banking. It doesn't matter about the $5 gas. Oh, and it's coming. Sorry. Good time to ride a bike. But I've overcome all that. That's what he said. Number four, this is a healing house. You want to know the name change? Well, the name change is still Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, but this house, this church name going forward is something that for 3 years we've prayed about and talked about and believe that God is wanting us to understand that this is a place of healing for the broken. That God wants this church to be proclaimed as a place of emotional, a place of mental, a place of physical healing, a place of spiritual healing. We're now currently this year, pandemic, yes. I don't care if we have to wear gas masks and, you know, suits. Rubber suits will do it. But we're going to lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. You know, Amy Simkel McPherson, during the last pandemic, you know what she did? She went out on the streets, laid hands on people, and watched them recover. Folks, I want to say to you, this needs to be a place of healing. Physical, emotional, spiritual, body, soul, and spirit, a place of healing. I only got a few more minutes. Let me go through this. You know the parable of the Good Samaritan. Folks, the parable of the Good Samaritan summed up very carefully. He asked, who's your neighbor? This asked of Jesus to trip him up. Who is your neighbor? And I ask you, who is your neighbor? Many will read the story of the Good Samaritan, and when they're done, they'll say, oh, my neighbor is the one who shows mercy on me. Because that's the answer. He says, and he said, who's your neighbor? He who shows mercy on him. But I want to give you the reality of that scripture, the part that they missed. Who's your neighbor? The person I can show mercy on. Did you hear me? It's not the person who shows me mercy. My neighbor is the person I can show mercy on. Who deserves judgment? Who's wrong that I can crush? But I choose to love. Who's your neighbor? Every broken person, every hurting person. You see, you're the kings and the priests. You're the Levites that walked by and saw a broken man and went to the other side to pass by so you could get as far away from his hurt, his pain, and his brokenness when you've been called to be the one to bind up his wounds. But instead, it took a Samaritan known as a Samaritan dog that would literally see it, the worst of the worst. See, God's saying, listen, I don't even care who you are. But you can be a neighbor to someone broken and hurting. Folks, I say to you today, this is a healing house. This is a house where we're not going to just walk to the other side. We're going to be the ones to walk to him, to scoop him up. We're not going to stop food ministry. Do you know, I had just in the last month someone say, well, if you've got any financial trouble, the first thing I would do is quit feeding people. Let me tell you a little secret. It's the last thing I want to do. Well, quit helping people. Quit giving away so much. That's a great idea, but guess what, folks? I can become the church like every other church who has a good church meeting. God stays outside and weeps, and they impress people, but they don't actually bind up anyone else's wounds. Those people don't feel comfortable coming in the house. Folks, I would hope to God. In fact, I'll be honest, if I see anyone treat anyone poorly, anyone broken, anyone hurting, anyone that comes in off the street, in this house, if you think for one second you have a right to walk on the other side, I have people say, well, I just don't want my children around those people. Then keep a good eye on them and teach your children how to love the hurting and the broken. That's the heart of God. This is the house of God. For A, we cannot just walk by. Religion dies here. Folks, this is not a place for religion to live. Religion, true religion, but a religious spirit dies in this place. I want it to suffocate in this house. Did you hear me? Religious spirit needs to suffocate in this house. That means it's got to suffocate in your house. 4B. Our neighbor is everyone we can show mercy to. So show mercy. Do it. Do it. Start showing mercy. What does that mean? The people that deserve it are the people you don't give it to. The people that need judgment, they're the people you lift up. The people who deserve to where they're at are the people that you raise out of the miry muck. 4C, together we bind up wounds. Psalms 147:3 says, he healed the brokenhearted. He bound up their wounds. You know what that word is best translated? Their sorrows. Their sorrows. 4D, healing all who are oppressed to the devil. Acts 10:34 through 46 says, and now Jesus, in 38, said, Jesus anointed, and God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. You know how that ends? Go out and do the same. He preached salvation. He preached an overflow of the Holy Spirit. This is about the house of Cornelius and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that they would have an outpouring of the Holy Spirit and magnify God, an outpouring of worship. Folks, this needs to be the house of God where there is an outpouring of the Holy Spirit and an outpouring of worship and an outpouring of salvation. In Mark 6:15, he gives the Great Commission. He says, go into all the world, that we are to lay hands on the sick and see them recover. Folks, this is a house of healing, emotionally, physically, spiritually. This is a house of healing, and I don't want us to forget it. You say, why the church name change? Because we're not going to forget that there is a purpose when we walk into this house. That not only are we healed, but that we bring forth, that we are anointed to bring healing to the broken. This is God's house, a place of healing. Number five, let's walk together into healing. Spirit, soul, and body. Walking together in a journey of health in our bodies, soul, and spirit. There's a little chart. I'm going to ask them to put it up. We're not going to teach on it today. I'm going to pray about it, teach on it next week. But I want you to just see, there's really should be just three, but with me, there's always an overflow. I had to break the soul into two parts, emotional and mental. I did that primarily because if you look at psychology, they actually break up those two separately. Biblically, those are one. Your mind, will, and emotions are your soul, okay? I broke them up because they're easier to understand and because your definitions go. But I want you to see there's a birthing of the fruit of the Spirit, and then there's a cultivating it, and then there's a determination, and then there's an action. See, folks, it's not enough for us to mean well. There's not enough for us to feel. It's not enough for us to decide until we do. Folks, there's a flow. It's only possible through a flow from the throne room of God into your spirit, into your soul, and through your actions in this world. That's how God wants to move in this church to bring healing to the broken. Folks, Crossfire is a place of healing. Crossfire is going to increase the supernatural gifts in the body, that's you. Increase the supernatural. That's why I asked, are you willing to go there? Are you willing to go there? See, we're gonna have our prayer team, but are you willing to make sacrifices of your flesh to walk in the Spirit? That was a question. Are you willing to kill your flesh? Well, Pastor, I think I can do both. Well, you're wrong. Because then God would be wrong. Are you willing to kill off your flesh and fleshly desires and what you want and to live the way you think and live by the premises and concepts and ideas of the world? See, the problem is that when it's birthed in the Spirit, but because of my emotional mess up, I'm unwilling to yield to the truth of God. By the time it actually comes out in my actions, it is perverted and it is ugly and it is wrong. That doesn't bring healing. It actually brings confusion. And the world and the devil love that. Nobody's perfect. What it should do is come out in humility, submitting and humbling yourself before God. Then your fruit brings life because it's His fruit. Will this be only a name change? Or is this a spirit change? Will we hang on until we're blessed? I hope so. Can we be our Father's house, about our Father's business? Are we willing to walk set apart for his work? Can we begin to walk in and bring healing to a broken world? Are you willing to be a good Samaritan? Folks, that's this church. It's not where you go. It's what's in you, and it's what comes out of you. And it will change this city, and it make effects on this world if we'll let it. Pastor Monty. I'm going to ask this one thing as he comes. I'm going to let him, if you do not know Christ, if you're away from him, if you're backslidden, we're going to pray with you. We'll mask up and pray with you. I'm going to encourage you to simply come and ask for that. But I'm going to ask each and every one of you, and please, please, please take what I'm about to say seriously. If you're willing to put to death the old man and his deeds, did you hear me? The new man doesn't operate in the old man's deeds. Are you willing to put to death the old man and his deeds and to walk in the Spirit? As a faithful member of this church, if you're willing to do that, that we could truly be a house of prayer, that we truly could be a place of healing, not hand out a few food boxes, not see a few people saved and baptized, but you're willing to choose to be a real part of a body of believers that will change something.
I want to thank you for watching, and if you need to commit your heart and life to Christ, there are people who would love to pray with you, talk with you, and I just want to encourage you to call the number at the bottom of the screen, 541-686-3473. That's 541-686-FIRE. If they're not able to answer, we can only answer so many calls. If they're not able to answer, leave a message. We will call you back. You can go to our website at mycrossfire.com, and there, there's a changing website and link, but you'll be able to click and find where you can read what it is to make a commitment to Christ, what it is to know Christ. But truly, this is a house. This church is a healing house. Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is at its very heart and root the local church. And it is all birthed out of a place of healing. This is a healing house. I believe that God has said that. He's spoken it. But it only works if you're willing to take his promises, take his word, and walk in healing. Walk in faith. Walk in the fullness of God. And walk out the miraculous that God has in store for you, both physically, spiritually, emotionally, mentally. God wants to work out in your life the healing power and the promises of God. If you need prayer today, give us a call, email us, go onto our website at our prayer blog. We meet and we pray about those things immediately. And then we meet once a week online and we pray for these things with a huge group of prayer warriors around the world that pray together and believe for God's very best and for great days that are ahead. And I want to also encourage you. I want to encourage you immensely that if you do not have a local church and you live in the Springfield or Eugene area, or if you're visiting, come by this church and see. There's a uniqueness to Crossfire Healing House Church. Just a real uniqueness of what God's doing. An incredible excitement of what God is doing right now in the land. And even though we have great adversity, we also have a great God, great power, great strength. God is truly doing great things. And I want you to be a part of that. I also want to encourage you, if you'd like to support this ministry, we don't harp on money. We don't beg for money. Even though if you say anything, some people are quickly offended. I want to tell you what a privilege it is to give. I was thankful to look at my giving statement this year and be able to know through avenues outside of this church and outside of this ministry, God enabled me to be able to bless this church, to be able to bless this ministry. There's no better place that I could plant seed that I would see develop that would bring a blessing to my home, to my house, to my faith, to my life, to everything in me. And as we got our year-end statements, I got it. And I got to tell you, I was shocked and thankful that I was able to do that. God enabled me to do something that was impossible. It was beyond my ability. And yet in doing so, he just continued to bless. He continued to bring blessing to my home, my life, and my family. I believe that'll happen to you. And so I want to encourage you, plant good seed in good soil. Is it soil that that maybe the world appreciates? I want to tell you something. The world needs this seed, and they need it to find good soil. The world and too often those people are church people, people that like to criticize and like to gossip. That is not church. That is not a house of healing. And when you run into Christians that want to backbite and criticize, they always got something bad to say about somebody else, I want to tell you something. Run far away. But when you find Christians who have faith in God, who bring unity to the body, who love one another, who care, that's when the miraculous really gets dumped in and great things happen. So I want to encourage you, connect with people who have faith, connect with people who believe in God and who take his promises, and watch miraculous things happen. Thanks for watching Crossfire Television. Thanks for your gifts, your support, your prayer. Thank you for all you do to help this ministry truly be a place of healing, a place where the will of God is done, and spreading the gospel by the Great Commission, by preaching the gospel throughout this community, throughout this nation, because it needs it so desperately, and throughout this world. It is amazing. It's humbling to watch what God can do when you simply yield your life. Start now, and let it begin by changing your life, your family, your community, your nation, and your world. Amen.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.